brother. Start cleaning those tires up.
Having a great time. Remember, they fan out down there. So protect that bottom. So Sunday drive.
All right, boss man. Hey, the car's off. Be ready.
Right, be ready. Gas that bitch up.
Ready, ready. Green flag.
Green.
First time in the history of ever, I didn't have the run sheet pre-printed before we started the show. Look at that. So I'm prepared.
But I did.
I know you did. Well, I could have pulled it up on the computer. I just didn't take the time to do it. Welcome to the Inside Pass, everybody. Another week of racing talk. Randy Miller, Tom Baker, Peter Schrader, Chris Murdoch, all in the studio. And Justice is here as well. He's overseeing things for Chris. He's a little assistant, apparently, I guess, tonight, right? Or is it the other way around?
Justice is learning.
He's learning.
L for learning.
Right.
Yes.
L for learning.
Justice Colabro.
All right, so we'll...
Future producer.
I'm sure he'll chime in at some point in time tonight. Maybe if Chris lets him, because Chris has the control over everything, so...
Which is why he just muted Randy.
Yes, and I knew he was doing it.
Yeah, so,
I didn't
so
talk
you didn't
when
say
did,
anything,
so.
Yeah.
So anyway, we do have a great show tonight. Alex Bowman will be on at some point in time tonight. Tom got to sit down with Alex later this past week. We'll see what Alex has on his mind. It was before the race weekend in Indy, but we'll see what's going on with Alex Bowman. We've also got some news that we want to discuss, some more silly season things that have happened in the NASCAR world. And, of course, as we mentioned, we will talk about Indy as well, as I guess there are a lot of varying opinions about what you saw over the weekend, or specifically yesterday, as we record this show on Monday. But I guess we'll see what varying opinions are out there with everybody. And, of course, Fantasy NASCAR as well we'll do later on in the show, too. And we're going to talk about Knoxville Nationals, too, because it kind of has a NASCAR tie-in if you didn't catch who won the Knoxville Nationals. So I guess we'll start with IndyCar, or not IndyCar, Indy. Well, I guess IndyCar was there, too, but Indianapolis Motor Speedway and the road course race, specifically Sunday, because I think that's where most everybody has a varying opinion about what happened on Sunday. Tracks falling apart and people wrecking, and it turned into a quite the show the last 10 laps of the race. Peter, we'll start with you. What did you think of the race itself, not necessarily all the controversy that happened in the last 25, 30 minutes of the race?
I thought it was certainly a bit unexpected, seeing Larson and I guess his two teammates, Elliott and Byron, run 1-2-3 for so much of the race. And of course, if everything didn't go to crap in the last 10 laps, then they would have finished 1-2-3 in whichever order. But obviously that didn't happen, and we got AJ Allmendinger winning again, which I don't think anyone expected, and Colic Racing going to victory lane as a part-time unchartered team, which I didn't think I'd be saying that sentence at all this year, but I'm glad I'm able to say it. But overall, I think we had an interesting race, to put it nicely, and I don't know. I'm still kind of missing the Indy Oval and the Brickyard 400.
Yeah, I am too. We'll talk about that too in a little bit. Tom, what was your opinion of the race?
I'm not missing the Oval at all.
Really?
The road course was great until the last 10 laps. And I think that's a factor of, you know, obviously what we saw with the curbing. They just have to come up with something different there, which we can, I guess, talk more about that later. But overall, I thought the race, I would give it a solid 8 or 8.5 on a 10 scale. I thought it was an interesting race. You had several different drivers up front. Like Peter said, the Hendrick cars kind of dominated a little bit of it. But there was a lot of action going on throughout the field, I thought, all the way through. I thought that the cars put on a good show on the road course, given that they'd never been on it before and had, you know, very little in the way of obviously data or anything, unless you had an Xfinity team that raced on it, you know, a year ago or whatever. But, you know, I enjoyed it. I thought it was good till the last 10 laps, and I don't fault, you know, I'm not going to throw the entire race away for what happened the last 10 laps. That was a particular issue with a particular part of the track.
It wasn't NASCAR's fault that IMS's track broke.
Right. That's also true. It was those were permanent IMS curbing issues that happened. It had nothing to do with anything NASCAR did.
Well, if you think about, you know, obviously that curbing and you know, every road course race we run, there's always some sort of curbing on the racetrack to keep, you know, keep cars in bounds, so to speak. But they've ran this course before. I mean, Xfinity ran it last year and Indy ran it last year. This is the first time NASCAR's ran it. But if you think about all of the times, you know, over the weekend that cars have ran over that curbing, I mean, obviously at some point in time, it's going to give. I mean, you've got cars running, you know, 90, 100 miles an hour over top of that curbing. all day long, you know, and so eventually it's going to break.
It's just the weight difference. You know, I don't think those curbs have ever, you know, had the weight of a cup car.
Obviously, any cars can't go over it because otherwise that would be a very dangerous situation. But
I just see, this is why I've never been a fan of that type of a deal. If you don't want a race car going past a certain point, put a wall there. That way they won't go past a certain point. The racers are going to use all of the racetrack.
At this point, you're talking about the turtle curbs and not the curb that broke.
No, I'm talking about the principle of curbing in general. I'm just saying that the reason that we use curbing anywhere for any purpose is strictly to try and discourage cars from going past the point of the curb.
They all did it anyway.
I mean, and that's what I'm saying. The way to stop it is simply put a wall there. You're not going to go through a wall. You know, and it's sad, but the
Bubba
fact
Wallace
is
disagrees.
Well, I mean, you know, that's
because you hit the wall. That's probably
well. Yeah, there's well the thing.
I was talking about
is,
the Roval when he went through the wall.
Yes,
well,
there you go. Through it. There's a.
I rest my case.
The thing with me is, I mean, you look in that same part of the track, and you had basically a speed mountain that was sitting over there, and it's like, to me that idea is just silly because drivers are always going to push the limit. So if you're going to use curbing, you've got to find something that's not going to pull up like that. They had issues on Saturday with that same spot, and obviously they did not do a good job of making the right kind of repair or, you know, correcting it for Sunday.
I know every caution that came out Sunday, there were people out there with sledgehammers and saws and
welders,
drills and welders trying to fix that thing.
Too late then.
That now that we've dug into IMS a little bit, the one thing I will praise them for is the track safety. I think sometimes we get we take for granted, you know, some of these things that tracks put in place around their speedways, and there was a tire barrier coming off of that same spot that I really didn't pay much attention to the whole race because nobody was ever out in the grass for us to pay attention to until Logano went about 100 and some into that tire barrier. And if that tire barrier wasn't there, there'd be a lot of hurt fans because that car would have went straight through that fence.
So. Well, yeah. I mean, it's good that they have that there, and there's all kinds of those, you know, type of barriers that you don't have to just have tires. But yeah, that was good. Yeah, I mean, that's why I'm saying I can separate the rest of the race from what happened with that curbing issue. I just think it's unfortunate that they obviously underestimated after Saturday how severe and serious that problem would be because, you know, they had the chance to correct it. And, you know, they didn't, or whatever, thought they had. I don't know.
For a while there, I thought they were going to go out and put tires there where that curb was because they were just moving tires around all over the place.
You just put a bunch of wrecked race cars right there. Somebody will end up running around. It kind of reminds me of the first year of the Roval race. You know, they had that little, like, kink or whatever that they put
the
back there.
The
chicane, and they had to end up moving it around because it was not enough room.
Yeah.
Coming out of one, going into the other one, and so they had to move it back a little bit. But it's trial and error. I mean, it's the first year for these guys running this configuration, and, you know, as years go on, I'm sure they'll fix it.
What didn't make any sense to me is after they removed the curbing, they still ran over the turtle, and everybody knows what a turtle does to the race car. I mean, Corey LaJoie went over that thing and made his car frown.
Literally.
And Michael McDowell launched in the air and did a 360.
Corey has face on the hood would it have actually frowned with him. Turned the smile upside down at Toys R Us kind of thing.
Yeah, but yeah. I mean, but he's right though. I mean, you know, these drivers live so much on the edge that they're trying to find every little square inch of space that they can find to cut the corner and cut the track.
Well, that's why I'm just, I mean, I think you find, and again, I'm not vilifying IMS at all. I'm just saying that
I also felt bad for Bubba, who got penalized for avoiding the wreck. He went around the back end of that curb and avoided Corey LaJoie and Michael McDowell and all those people and got sent to the rear because he cut the course. Like, you would rather him wreck than not?
Right. Well, that's why I'm saying sometimes NASCAR, you need to use a little judgment.
Common sense.
Sometimes. And there are exceptions to every rule. And, you know, that was one of the situations. That's a good example of that kind of situation for me. Is, you know, Bubba was clearly trying to avoid rather than to do anything, you know, underhanded or gain.
And didn't
spots
Corey and, do the same thing before, like the caution before, where he just said nope and like went around it?
I don't know. I
and
didn't see it.
He kept his spot.
He may have. But it's just too bad. You know, again, that the last 10 laps was a dumpster fire, but, you know, the race, obviously seeing AJ win was great. Colleague, you know, that they're such a classy bunch of people, that you just always have to be happy, Peter, whenever AJ Allmendinger wins or Colleague Racing wins, cause they're just all great people.
Couldn't say better myself. Is there any group of people that just looks like they're having more fun every Saturday or Sunday at the racetrack? I mean, that whole team, the whole chemistry just feels like one big happy family. I know AJ and Justin Haley and Ross Chastain used to joke they were like father and son and uncle or whatever, but still, they honestly do feel like one big happy family. Matt Colley, Chris Rice, everyone over there.
Well, and that's the atmosphere that Chris and Matt instill in that group is that family and atmosphere, and that's what good leadership does. And look what they've accomplished with what they have. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's, you know, I think they've got a good chance to succeed in the Cup Series going forward because of that.
You can ask anybody in the garage area what they think about Chris Rice, Matt Colley, and anybody in the organization, and they'll tell you how genuinely, like, positive the whole organization is. Chris is always, you know, trying to keep a momentum and trying to keep the team positive and positive outlook on everything. And it shows in the results. I mean, you can tell, you know, not only from the Xfinity side, but also from the Cup side as well. So we are going to step aside here and take a break. When we come back from break, Tom had the opportunity to sit down earlier this week with Alex Bowman and talk to him about his season so far and the run to the playoffs. And we will have that interview when we come back. More of the Inside Pass is right after this. Stick with us. We'll be right back.
Do you love the sound of high revving motors and the smell of burning rubber? Do you want to get your car sideways right at the ragged edge of control? If you've always wanted to try drifting or learn to improve your drifting skills, Summit Point Motorsports Park, the Mid-Atlantic's premier motorsports facility, has the expert instructors and the specialized track to teach you how to drift and the skills necessary to drift competitively. From skid pad to open sessions, Summit Point Motorsports Park has the safe and open environment that allows drifters of all skill levels, new to intermediate, to get sideways and smoking. With a focus on safety and the skill set necessary to drift competitively, Summit Point Motorsports Park's Drift Nirvana is just the thing for you. Call for your reservation today, 304-725-8444. Or for more information, go online, summitpoint-raceway.com, or you can email them at office@bsrinc.com. Drift Nirvana, getting you sideways the right way.
Victory Custom Trailers is the place to go for your next new or used trailer or coach. Being personally involved in the racing community allows Victory to fully understand what racers need in a trailer. They have over 200 coaches and trailers in stock for a variety of industries, and they can serve anyone in the continental U.S. If you're looking for something custom, they can assist in designing a trailer to fit your needs. Check out their entire inventory online at victorycustomtrailers.com.
I'm Andrew Saul, Commissioner of Social Security. Beware of telephone scammers pretending to be government employees. Real Social Security employees will never threaten you. Callers threatening you with arrest or other legal action and demanding money are not from us. If you receive a call like this, hang up, do not provide them with any form of payment or information, report the call at oig.ssa.
What an awesome game. What's up with your car?
I don't know. It won't start.
How are we getting home?
Chill. My parents signed me up for the roadside assistance from Lewis Meineke. It was free with my oil change. They'll come and get the car started or get us home and tow the car to the shop.
Good to know. With my driving, my parents never know what to expect.
When you join the Meineke Car Care Club with a $35 preferred service, you get 4 free months of roadside assistance, including tire change, battery jump, lockout service, towing, and more. Contact Lewis Meineke, located on Route 1, or call 827-2054.
When do you think of a plumber? Like most people, even if it's an emergency, you can be confident about who will arrive arrive to help you. For quality and reliability, count on someone you can trust. Call on the plumbing services of Hague Quality Water of Maryland. Plumbing doesn't have to be an emergency. We handle all kinds of preventative maintenance, too. Hague Quality Water of Maryland is family-owned here in Annapolis since 1993. For a refreshing choice, call us at 888-84-WATER or visit us online.
This is Justin Loft, and you're listening to the best guys on the radio, The Inside Cast.
Bowman joins us on the show now, and great to have Alex back with us here on the Inside Pass. And Alex, of course, if you're under a rock, drives the Ally Chevrolet for Rick Hendrick Motorsports in the Cup Series. Right now, sitting, I think, sixth in points, playoff points anyways. Three wins, six top five finishes, 12 top 10 finishes. Tied for the most wins in the series right now with Martin Truex. Two behind your teammate, Kyle Larson. Not a bad season at all so far, Alex, for you and the Ally team.
Yeah, thanks. It's been a good start to the year. We've had some ups and downs and some weekends that were a little painful, but, you know, also having three wins kind of makes some of that hurt a little less. So, you know, it's been a great year driving the 48 and working with Ally. It's been a lot of fun. So, hopefully we have a good playoff run, just kind of getting geared up, ready to go for that. Gone to a couple road courses the last couple weeks. We're here in Indy, and excited to see how it goes.
Yeah, talk about the road course side of things a little bit for you, because obviously that wasn't your background. So what's it been like for you as you've come up through the ranks? And of course, now we've got several more of them in the Cup Series than we've had in past years. So talk a little bit about the road course side. Do you enjoy it, and how are you adapting to it?
Yeah, I definitely enjoy it a lot. It's a lot of fun. I would say it's not very natural for me, and it's definitely difficult, but I enjoy it. We've had some really good runs. We've also had some poor runs. Like last week at Watkins Glen, we really struggled a lot more than we thought we were going to. So, you know, we're a little hit and miss with it, but we've also had some strong runs. We've run top three a couple times at some road courses. So, you know, hopefully we have a good one here in Indy this week. It's kind of an unknown with the track that most of us have never been on, so excited, ready to get rolling. And, you know, the HMS road course cars are always super strong, so just got to do my job behind the wheel.
I was going to ask you about that, because obviously first time on the Indy road course, running the race formerly known as the Brickyard 400, I guess we could say. Do you like the change over to the road course? And kind of, I mean, how does that feel going into it to know that you're not going to be running on the famed Indy Oval?
Yeah, I mean, personally, I'd rather run Raceway Park down the road, but
hey, me too.
You know, yeah, the Brickyard's a really special place, and I think it's special no matter what course you're running on it. And you know, obviously, it's an honor to get to race on that racetrack. So, you know, I'm all good with whatever track we're running on. We all gonna race the same racetrack. The oval at Indianapolis is a little awkward in a stock car. Didn't ever make for a great race with kind of the way the race cars have progressed over the years. And excited to see how the race goes with the Cup cars on the road course. You know, the Xfinity race last year was phenomenal. So hopefully it goes pretty well. But, you know, I do love Raceway Park, and I wish we could get a race back there. We're running the midget race there tomorrow night. Josh Wise is driving my car there. We spent all day yesterday there practicing.
Nice.
So that place has a special place in my heart. But, you know, the big track is also special, no matter if it's the oval or the road course or whatever.
Well, you've got
three races left before the playoffs start. You've got Indy, the road course this weekend. Then you go to Michigan, big track. And then you go to Daytona, which is always basically a toss-up, right? So to end the regular season, you've got to feel really good about your situation going into the playoffs, given that you've got three wins. Hendrick Motorsports as a whole seems to be stronger this year than it has in maybe a decade or more. Talk a little bit about how you feel about the last three races and going into the playoffs at Darlington.
Yeah, the run-up to the playoffs is almost kind of an awkward set of races, right? You have Watkins Glen, Indy, Michigan, Daytona coming off of 2 weeks off. So it's a little different going through that batch of races. But, you know, hopefully we can get some momentum rolling the right direction and be prepared, ready to go when we get to Darlington. Michigan has been rough on us over the last couple of years, but I think our engine shop is doing a phenomenal job these days, and they always have been, but especially lately. I think that'll help us a lot when we get to Michigan, and Daytona kind of is what it is. So excited to, like I said, just try to build some momentum. Last year we didn't have really any momentum going into the playoffs, and still had a great playoff run. So I feel like, you know, if we can do similar to what we did last year, sprinkle some wins in through the playoffs, we can hopefully make it all the way to Phoenix and be in contention there.
Brand new car coming to the Cup Series in 2022. Lots of buzz about it from all sides and kind of all different points of view. Talk a little bit about your thoughts going into next year with the new car and what you think about the car itself and how it may change the racing a little bit.
Yeah, it's going to be different. I don't really know what to expect. I drove it at Martinsville, and it's way different than the current car, and I think we're all just going to have to adapt to it. I'm all for a new challenge and excited to learn how it drives and figure out how to dial it in and race it and be successful with it. But it's definitely going to be tough just with how different it is. So I know the teams have just started to get some cars and have a ton of work ahead of them. There are some things that I think are really cool about it and some things that are going to be challenges for us with it. But, it's a clean slate. It's the same for everybody. And we just got to figure out how to optimize it, what the car does and doesn't like, and really how to drive it. I feel like about everybody that's driven them has crashed them. So, got to figure out how to not do that and go from there.
Yeah, you don't want to be a crash test dummy, that's for sure. Talk a little bit about, if you can, more specifically, what is different? What kind of a feel is it for a driver compared to the current car, as much as you can tell us?
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing is the current car, you can slide around a lot, drive pretty yawed out and sideways, and you have a much bigger sidewall, so the tire is more forgiving. The car makes more side force, so you can slide it more and catch it. Whereas this new car, all that goes away. It's kind of like a razor's edge, where as soon as it steps out, you just end up spinning out or whatever. So just learning how to drive more of that, like, razor's edge, can't step over the line. Like, you can't run 101% because you'll crash it. You have to run 99.95% every lap, and that's going to be way different for me, at least. I feel like I kind of drive kind of right at the peak of the tire grip and overslip the tire at times, and I think if you overslip the right rear tire specifically on the next-gen car, you're typically going to be going for a ride. So just learning how to kind of live on that edge where the line is so much finer is going to be the difficult part of that car. And we're all going to have to adapt to it and go from there.
Almost feels like stepping back in time to the days when driver input was so much more key to the race car's performance. So it should be interesting to see how that goes. And I know one of the reasons you probably drive the way you do is because, well, you love the open wheel stuff, and you've got your open wheel team you mentioned running this weekend with Josh. Talk about what else you got coming up.
Yeah, it's been a lot of fun this year with ABR. We've had a lot of support from Valvoline, and Ally jumped on board as well. And I went wing sprint car racing for the first time a couple weeks ago and had an absolute blast doing that. So we don't have much the rest of the year. I think we have five or six races left, and just kind of CJ Leary is going to hit some races in the wing car and do something for World Finals. Still not sure who's going to drive it there. I feel like we're all busy. I'm going to be in Phoenix. CJ will be in California. So got to figure out what we're doing there, but it's too close to home not to go. So other than that, we don't really have much, you know, just kind of gearing up for next year, building a couple new cars for next year. And I'm probably going to run a lot of wing sprint car races next year and, nice. And try to have a lot of fun with it. So excited about that. That's something I always wanted to do. I don't have a huge dirt background. I ran some midget stuff, but most of the midget stuff I ran was on pavement. So the wing sprint car is pretty much as far out of my comfort zone as you can get. And, you know, just trying to be out there and learn what I can has been a lot of fun.
Well, look forward to seeing more of you on the open wheel side next year. Sounds like that'll be a real challenge. New cup car and more dirt track stuff with the wings sprint car. That should be a lot of fun. Alex, it's always great to have you on the show. We appreciate you taking some of your time from Indy to talk to us. We wish you all the best this weekend and going down the stretch this year as you try for that first championship.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks for having me. Have a good one.
What an awesome guy, Alex Bowman, isn't he? I guess spoiled some breaking news that he's going to run some more sprint car races next year. He probably needs to stop hanging out with Kyle Larson.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, he's rubbing off on everybody.
It's the in thing now, all these NASCAR guys. They all have dirt teams and go race dirt in their spare time, and I, for one, think that's pretty darn cool, Peter.
I do as well, and I think that Ally sprint car he has is just beautiful. If they made a die-cast of that, I would 100% get that, just because I love those Ally colors, especially the purple on a sprint car.
You know, I feel like they could save a lot of money if they just put all the sprint cars in one hauler at Hendrick and just took them all at one time. A lot of money saved. They wouldn't have to be, you know, bumming rides off of each other, but that's awesome.
Where is the shop? That might not be public knowledge. Is it still his house?
No.
Alex's shop?
Yeah.
No. I don't think it is. I know where I believe he is now, but I don't think it's public knowledge, so I'm not going to say. But I heard something not long ago. I think I know where he is.
Well, awesome. Good to see that he's getting out and doing some sprint car races. He made his debut just a few weeks ago and ended up in the top five. So obviously he knows how to wheel a sprint car, so it's good to see that he's out and going to run some more sprint car races next year. We do have another piece of breaking news, but I want to save it for after the break because we only have, 22 seconds left, and I really don't want to get into it right now. But anyway, when we come back from break, we do have some other news of note that we want to talk about, including some silly season news that might be some interesting topic of conversation. We've got fantasy NASCAR as well. And we'll talk about the Knoxville Nationals. Some more sprint car racing news is on the way. We'll be back with more of the Inside Pass right after this. Stick with us.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Automotive technicians and auto service trainees, how would you like to work at the beach and perform for one of the best car care centers in the nation? Lewis Meineke is now looking for skilled automotive technicians to join their award-winning team. If you're a gearhead that knows his or her stuff, or a young up-and-comer that has the motivation and drive to succeed, then you need to make this call today. 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center, located in beautiful Lewis, Delaware, offers a highly competitive compensation plan, great benefits, a flexible schedule, and did we mention that you're going to be working at the beach? Plus, there's a signing bonus for the right candidates. Technicians must be ASE certified and have a minimum of 6 years' experience. Beginners, advance at your own pace in one of several entry-level positions. But whatever you do, don't wait. These jobs will go fast. Call Tim at 302-827-2054. That's 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center. Rev up your career.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
Victory Custom Trailers is the place to go for your next new or used trailer or coach.
Being personally involved in the racing community allows Victory to fully understand what racers need in a trailer. They have over 200 coaches and trailers in stock for a variety of industries, and they can serve anyone in the continental U.S. If you're looking for something custom, they can assist in designing a trailer to fit your needs. Check out their entire inventory online at victorycustomtrailers.com.
He wanted to be known for doing his best.
You're right.
His best made him Major League Baseball's most valuable player.
Strike two.
He played in 6 World Series and was elected to the Hall of Fame. Oh. Although an honest man, he was best at stealing home.
Save.
But the best quality of Jackie Robinson's life was his character. So here's to you, Mr. Robinson. Thanks for passing it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
I'm Matt DiBenedetto, the brutally honest NASCAR driver, and you're listening to the Inside Pass.
Got to give credit to Matt DiBenedetto, finishing 5th in the race at Indy over the weekend. As Peter always says, too little, too late, but you know, at least he's auditioning for something for next year. So it's always good to have him go out there and get a good finishing run. Welcome back to the Inside Pass. Randy Miller, Tom Baker, Peter Strada, Chris Murdoch pushing buttons. Justice is learning how to push buttons, and so in the weeks to come, he'll probably sit in.
He's being learned. He's being schooled.
He's being schooled.
He's being schooled.
As
right
they would say in my hometown from Ohio, he's being learned.
He's being learned. Edumacated. Before we went to break, I mentioned we had breaking news. Noah's back next week.
That's breaking news?
Well,
Wait, say that again.
Noah's back next week.
I'm happy to have him back, but I don't know. Does that qualify? I guess it's breaking news.
I mean, it's
breaking news for us.
It's breaking news for us only because we haven't been able to.
That's what you get
to,
for calling Noah breaking news.
Well, no. Hear me out now. Hold on. I'm going to get you guys on my side. Listen. We haven't had anybody to pick on for the last 7 weeks.
I pick on you just fine.
Well, I know you and I do, but it's, you know, you always need the one-armed man in a butt-kicking contest, and Noah's that person. So we need him back because we need somebody that we can bounce things off of.
We just need it to not be you anymore.
As long as he doesn't text and walk downstairs anymore.
I can take the punishment just fine. I always have, but I'm a lot more strong-willed than Noah. We make Noah cry when he's here, and I really don't. I mean,
that's why I had to take a vacation.
It's fun, is what it is. I mean, that's all it is to it. It's just,
you know what?
It's fun.
We make him cry, so he went away and made kids at camp cry.
I've seen some of the pictures he's posted on social media. The terror in their eyes.
You know that saying, "Crap runs downhill." That's what just happened. You know,
pretty much. Its name is Noah, and it's it doesn't run downhill. It rolls downhill.
Wow.
He doesn't. We're just joking, folks. He
for
doesn't
those
run.
Of you who don't know this is we're just picking on.
Clearly, if anybody's listening
Noah
to the show,
a co-host,
he's not capable of running and doing anything. So he's only rolling downhill.
Randy is just holy. Well, I mean,
he's not even back yet. So. All right, anyway.
I mean, he did fall downstairs.
He did while trying to text. So, he brought it on himself. It's his own ridicule. Anyway, so let's get to some of the news stories of the week. There's a story that came out last week that a Mystery Truck Series team is looking to partner with TRD for a Cup Series entry in 2022, which is leading a lot of people to point fingers and ask, what truck team could that be?
Cough, GMS.
Well, from what I've seen in the article, it's not GMS because GMS is already it's a team that hasn't announced a plan yet. GMS has announced some sort of plan that they're going to go.
But they did not announce a manufacturer in that plan.
That is true,
Peter.
Another piece of this was maybe announced today because it was announced that Bubba Wallace will be in the Hattori 61 for the Xfinity race in Michigan this weekend because Austin Hill was supposed to be in this car, but with trucks being in Gateway, he likely can't make both races. And if either has a weather delay, then
it
he definitely
can't.
It's
hard to be two places at once.
Well, so it could be Hattori going.
You know
to
what
Cup.
I was disappointed in, and this is going back to Indy real quick. Cody Ware was the only person to do the double, and he finished but last in each race.
And you know what's interesting about that is I really didn't even pay any attention to the fact that he was doing the double.
He was the only driver that weekend to run the IndyCar race and the Cup race, and he finished
well
dead
this
last
year,
in both.
Especially I think COVID kind of played a part in that. I think just the crossover we saw between IndyCar drivers watching the NASCAR races and NASCAR drivers watching the IndyCar race. I think in a non-pandemic year, we'll definitely see more crossover, more cross-pollination.
I don't know if you will, and the only reason I say that is because each is so specialized now that it isn't... I mean, I'm not saying there wouldn't be some that would want to do it, but... It's just not like it was in the 70s or 80s.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds.
My elbow hit the button.
We don't have 15 seconds. We have 7 minutes and 23 seconds. You'll find out what happens in that. You're 7 minutes and 20 seconds.
I was foreshadowing.
They're going to love that tease. Now everyone is going to stick around. I wonder what happens. I wonder how you can be a dad in 15 seconds. I want to see
that
what
was such a funny comeback that I almost want to take back the buzzer now because he redeemed himself so well with a comeback.
That's a tease.
Foreshadowing.
But no, back to what Peter was saying. I made that point to Tom in the car ride up here that Bubba Wallace running a race for Hattori in the 61 may be a sort of a tell about Hattori going to the Cup Series.
It could be. I don't know. It's interesting to me because I do think that Toyota obviously at some point is going to need to expand their Cup roster.
Of course.
I mean, they can't just keep having, you know, five cars forever.
Well, they may also be expanding it with, you know, buying Front Row.
It's true. We'll get to that in a second.
Well, yeah, I mean, so... The idea that there is a truck team that could, I mean, Thor Sport perhaps.
I don't think Kyle Busch wants a Cup team.
No, I wasn't even going to suggest KBM because I don't think that's a plan at all. I mean, you got Thor Sport, you got Hattori, you know, you got, it could be Front Row, but I doubt it. GMS didn't announce a manufacturer, so that could be sneaky. You know, and I would almost say that I would bet my money on GMS, except that if GMS goes to Toyota, then basically the whole Chevy driver's edge deal, driver development deal, goes completely kaput because Junior Motorsports is really no longer, I mean, they're kind of still involved, but not really. And then GMS was the team that was kind of acing that. So if they were to go to the Cup Series and change manufacturers, then obviously, so it would be interesting to see what happens there. I don't know. That's I saw the announcement. I'm just waiting to see what comes of it because I do think there are a few teams that could possibly be in play there.
So as Chris was mentioning, there's a possibility that Toyota could be involved in the Front Row Motorsports situation. Apparently, there is a rumor around that 2311 and Front Row Motorsports could be on the verge
of a merger.
Which I've
heard multiple rumors about Front Row, which leads me to believe that something is going to happen with Front Row.
Where there's smoke, there's fire.
Because I heard that, you know, a couple weeks ago, I think I mentioned on the show that Kevin Harvick would be interested
in buying. Well, at that point, it wasn't Front Row. It was the
JTG.
Yeah, it wasn't Front Row. It would make more sense for him to buy Front Row because of Ford team. But I guess you can be anything nowadays. They're getting new cars anyway. But I don't know. Again, that just... I would hate to see Bob Jenkins go, I'll put it that way. If Toyota swallows up Front Row... And basically makes it all 2311, as is the rumor, which would be, by the way, you say, well, why would they do that? Charters.
Yeah.
You know,
what's this mindset now that I said a couple weeks ago when Trackhouse bought CGR and is ending and is taking away another Cup team at the end of the year? It's the mentality of if I can't lease a charter, I'll just go buy a team.
Yeah, and what's going to happen is we're going to be back to 36 running teams because there's only 36 doggone charters. That's my biggest problem with the charter system is that the direction we're seeing it go here is that people are buying teams to have charters, and then they're taking away, if they only want two teams and they buy a three-car team, they're taking away one of the teams and still being two because that's all the charters they have. So you're going to net lose teams out of this whole thing if you believe all these rumors. So, and I think Bob Jenkins is one of the hardest working, classiest gentlemen in the garage. And much like Bob Levine, I think he would be greatly missed if this were just a flat out sale. Now, if it were some sort of merger where Front Row is still Front Row, but they're just Toyota and getting some sort of support from 2311 or whatever, then that might be one thing. But I don't think that's what this appears to be. I think this is a charter situation. So at that point, you'd be talking about just buying Front Row out for the charters.
Well, the other caveat to that is there's a possibility of them leasing a charter from Front Row, which I think they only have two, right?
Front Row has two, I believe.
If they're leasing a charter, that means one of the two cars is going away.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If that's the case, unless Front Row would operate the other one without a charter, but, you know,
I don't think the driver lineup is strong enough to have without a charter.
Well,
maybe a Daytona, I agree, or Talladega, but,
you know, so that would probably be bad for Anthony Alfredo. You know, much as I said that not having a charter would be bad for Ryan Preece at JTG, and I think it's proven out. You know, it's just a tough situation. I feel like the charter is really
Ryan's
just
done,
muddying the waters.
Ryan's done really good to keep himself in all of these races this year without a charter.
Well, yes, but at the end of the day, it's gonna end up coming back to haunt him because. Without the charter, first of all, he's made all the races because there haven't been an overload of cars at very many of them. And he's run fast, but the car hasn't finished well. So the advantage of the charter is you get a bigger portion of the purse. And so
the good thing that will happen when some of these open cars start next year is we'll be back to practice and qualifying. So Ross B.
Maybe.
We'll be back to practice and qualifying.
Has that been announced?
Raw speed will matter.
I'm not sure that's going to happen, to be honest. I think a lot of it depends on COVID and other factors. I'm not sold that we're going to be back to practice and qualifying every week next year. And so, you know, I'm not sure, you know, where that takes us. But I understand the value of the charters. And I understand that it can be a big windfall. Like if you sell a couple charters for $10 million apiece, you've just put $20 million in your pocket. But I don't necessarily think that does anything to help the racing. You know, I think the charters have muddied the waters more than they've helped it. In all honesty, because we would have been looking at probably 45 teams next year. But you take away one of the Ganassi cars. And, you know, you possibly take away, you know, a Front Row car, you're losing cars.
That's right. All right, we were going to take a break. We'll be back more of the Inside Pass right after this.
How to be a great dad in 15 seconds. Bike ride, go fish, walk in the park, phone call, milkshake, play catch, picnic, fly a kite, tell jokes, laugh, talk, read a story, tell a story, bumper car, swing set, bowling, pillow fight, cut loose, stay tight. Whew. Because the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today. Call 877-4DAD-411 or visit fatherhood.gov. Brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Automotive technicians and auto service trainees, how would you like to work at the beach and perform for one of the best car care centers in the nation? Lewis Meineke is now looking for skilled automotive technicians to join their award-winning team. If you're a gearhead that knows his or her stuff or a young up-and-comer that has the motivation and drive to succeed, then you need to make this call today. 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center, located in beautiful Lewis, Delaware, offers a highly competitive compensation plan, great benefits, a flexible schedule, and did we mention that you're going to be working at the beach? Plus, there's a signing bonus for the right candidates. Technicians must be ASE certified and have a minimum of 6 years experience. Beginners advance at your own pace in one of several entry-level positions. But whatever you do, don't wait. These jobs will go fast. Call Tim at 302-827-2054. That's 302-827-2054. Lewis Meineke Car Care Center. Rev up your career.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right. It's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette. It's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes. On Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
He wanted to be known for doing his best.
Sure, you're right.
His best made him Major League Baseball's most valuable player.
Strike two.
He played in 6 World Series and was elected to the Hall of Fame. Although an honest man, he was best at stealing home. But the best quality of Jackie Robinson's life was his character. So here's to you, Mr. Robinson. Thanks for passing it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
When Marlon Shirley was 5 years old, he was in an accident and lost his foot, but he didn't lose his heart.
When you tackle a challenge that you just cannot even fathom tackling, when you accomplish that, the amount of integrity and the will and the heart that you'll get from that experience is what will set you up for your life.
In less time than it took Marlon Shirley to say that, he can now run 100 meters because today he's the world's fastest amputee. Overcome. Pass it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com.
Hi, I'm Mark Lynette. You're not making it work on the outside. Make sure you listen to the inside pass.
Welcome back to the Inside Pass here on WSIC. And we thank WSIC for allowing us to come into your homes each and every Saturday morning at 9:30 a.m.
If nine.
Nine. Don't tune in at 9:30. You'd be halfway late.
Yes.
Halfway late. And you would have missed Alex Bowman at that point, too. But this is episode number 228 of our show, or actually 227 of our show, and 94 for WSIC. So we're approaching 100 episodes with WSIC, and we thank them so much for their hospitality in letting us do our show from their studio. So Fantasy NASCAR is up next. We've got 3 races this weekend. Gateway for the Trucks, the round number 1 of the playoffs, and Michigan for the Xfinity and the Cup Series. So I'm going to let Chris go first, since Justice is running the ship right now.
We've put him off the bench and put him in the game. For Trucks, it's going to be John Hunter. Xfinity will be Daniel Hemric, and for Cup, it'll be Kyle Larson.
Of course it's Kyle Larson. Why would you pick against Kyle Larson? All right, Peter, you're next.
All right, well, 2 of my 3 are the same as Chris's. I'll go for Trucks, John Hunter, because why not? He's the fastest truck all year. Xfinity, I'm liking Daniel Hemric finally getting a first win this weekend. But Cup, I'm going Kevin Harvick, because he's been just about perfect in recent years at Michigan.
I like, other than Trucks and Xfinity bandwagoning, I like the Cup Series picks. All right, Tom, you're up next.
I was trying to see who is in the 54 for Xfinity this week.
I'll go then while you're...
It's Ty Gibbs.
It is Ty. Okay, so I'm going, in the Truck Series, I'm going John Hunter. In the Xfinity Series, Ty Gibbs, and in the Cup Series, Kyle Larson.
All right, I'm going to go out on a little bit of a limb here, because I'm leading the points by 33 over Noah, who doesn't matter right now. And Noah's got a pretty sizable lead right now over Peter and Tom. So I feel like I have a little bit of leeway.
Look,
here.
It should be like the Cup Series. If he misses, he doesn't get a playoff waiver. He hasn't been here. He's missed all these weeks.
Yeah, go take your turtles and go home. So anyway, in the Truck Series, I'm going to pick Chandler Smith, because I feel like he's due for a win at some point. Why not Gateway? For Xfinity, I'm taking Justin Allgaier, and for Cup, Alex Bowman. I'm going to do 3 completely different picks.
Bowman the showman.
Yeah. So I'm either going to be really, really good, or I'll be down there with Nick at the bottom of the barrel. So we'll see what happens.
Yeah, exactly.
come the end of the week. So those are our picks, and we'll get the other boys' picks later on in the week. So with about 5 minutes or so left in the show, there's 2 things I want to mention. Number 1, we had breaking news this afternoon. Josh Berry is going to be a full-time Xfinity Series competitor next year, driving for Junior Motorsports, and so there were a lot of questions about who wouldn't be in a ride next year, but I heard part of an interview that JRM did with SiriusXM today. They were on SiriusXM Speedway, and Kelly was talking about how, as of right now, the plan is to run 5 cars next year. They want all 4 drivers to return. Sam Mayer, Noah, Michael Lynette, and Justin Allgaier, as well as having Josh Berry full-time. Of course, only Sam Mayer and Josh Berry have contracts for next year, so they have to work out contracts with the other 3. But the conceivable plan right now, Tom, is for them to run a five-car junior motorsport stable next year.
Okay, so that would have been option C, because we were kind of looking and thinking that at some point maybe Noah Gregson moves up or goes elsewhere, and Sam slides into the nine. But if they're talking about five Xfinity Series teams, that's actually really interesting, Peter, considering that Dale Jr. has spent a lot of time lately talking about how it appeared that running a Cup team would be far cheaper than running an Xfinity team next year.
Well, ultimately, with drivers like Justin Allgaier, who's loyal to Brandt, his sponsor Brandt, or Noah Gragson with Bass Pro Shops, they're very funded drivers, and Sam Mayer also brings money. So if you bring enough funding, you're bound to get a ride at Junior Motorsports. So it's kind of a, not a pay-to-play deal, but kind of a pay-to-play deal, where if you bring a check, you'll get a ride.
And for those who might ask, I thought you could only have four cars. That's only in the Cup Series.
That's true.
No limits in the other two series.
Well, maybe this is a precursor to what might happen in 2023. So maybe in 2022, there's five Xfinity teams, and maybe they're looking at maybe a Cup team in 2023. Maybe he's just going to put it off for another year.
Well, Junior told me that, or didn't tell me, he told the world, basically, that on his download that he would not pay $10 million for a charter.
Course, right.
So unless the charters go down, he's happy they are $10 million apiece because it's growing the value of the sport, but he isn't going to spend the $10 million to get one.
We'll see what happens. So the other piece of news that we want to share with you, of course, is Knoxville Nationals happening over the weekend. And lo and behold, Kyle Larson ends up in victory lane. So now he's won two of the major crown jewel races in sprint cars this year, with the Chili Bowl in January and now the Knoxville Nationals this year. He has plans of running the BC39 this coming weekend, so we'll see if he gets another crown jewel win, Peter. And then there's more on his bucket list. The World 100 for the late models is another race he really wants to win, and of course the Daytona 500 in 2022 is his other crown jewel race he wants to win.
And then just think about what he has left this year in the NASCAR Cup Series side of things. He has the Southern 500 still in front of him, and of course the championship, and with all the bonus points he almost has a free ticket to Phoenix, so he can start working on that Phoenix car just about now.
And oh, by the way, he's also now the point leader in the Cup Series.
By
22 points over Denny Hamlin. So he's now in line to become the regular season champion, which is another 15-point bonus, Tom, on top of everything else that he's got going for him.
Yeah, I was. I actually had, here it is, actually. Here is Kyle Larson's 2021 season so far. He's won the Chili Bowl. He's won the Coca-Cola 600. He's won the All-Star Race, the $1 million that goes with it. He's won the Kings Royal, the Prairie Dirt Classic, and the Knoxville Nationals. All in the same season so far, plus a few other cup races that they didn't mention in there.
Exactly.
So, I mean, the guy has just been off the chain this year. This is one of the greatest seasons, I would argue, by any driver in the history of motorsports.
So at what point, Peter, does he become one of the greatest drivers of all time?
I think that happens when you see him make an Indy 500 star, whenever that
ago.
Is.
I think he's already there. I mean, honestly, I think he's already there. He is going to, if he keeps going the way he is, he's going to be mentioned in the same breath as the AJ Foyts, the Tony Stewarts, the Mario Andretti's. I mean, now he may never get an Indy or Formula One part of the thing, but, you know, his ability to jump in a car, he's won, you know, dirt late model races. It's incredible what the guy can do. And he jumps into a car he's never driven and instantly adapts. That is a gift.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there's also a push from fans and some other drivers to Roger Penske to have somewhere along the way find Kyle Larson a ride for the Indy 500 next
I'd love
year.
To see it.
Well,
I would
double.
Too.
Never I don't think it's, about that.
I don't think it's up to Roger Penske to find him a ride. I think it's just if Rick Hendrick approves Kyle to race in the 500, I think somebody would give him a ride. But I'm not so sure that, you know, at this point that Kyle would even want to do that, because I think he's really focused on the NASCAR stuff right now, even though, yes, he's running a lot of dirt in between. When you go race the Indy 500, it's a whole month of back and forth and practice and all of that, and you really got to – I'm not sure Kyle would want to do that right now, maybe at some point later, but and he's got plenty of time. He's still young.
Indy cars have wings. Why not? We are going to get out of here for this week. We thank everybody for joining us. If you missed any part of Alex Bowman's interview or any of our show, make sure you catch it on demand at your favorite podcasting website, or ask your Alexa or Amazon to play the latest episode. That is all for this week. Have a great weekend, everybody. See you guys next time on the Inside Pass.